Keep me safe, O God, for I have come to you for refuge. I said to the Lord, you are my master. All the good things I have are from you. The godly people in the land are my true heroes. I take pleasure in them. Those who chase after other gods will be filled with sorrow. I will not take part in their sacrifices or even speak the names of their gods. Lord, you alone are my inheritance, my cup of blessing. You guard all that is mine. The land you have given me is a pleasant land. What a wonderful inheritance. I will bless the Lord who guides me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I know the Lord is always with me. I will not be shaken, for he is right beside me. No wonder my heart is filled with joy, and my mouth shouts his praises. My body rests in safety, for you will not leave my soul among the dead or allow your godly one to rot in the grave. You will show me the way of life, granting me the joy of your presence and the pleasures of living with you forever.
Pastures green.
But it was the Lord's good plan to crush him and to fill him with grief. Yet when his life is made an offering for sin, he will have a multitude of children, many heirs. He will enjoy a long life, and the Lord's plan will prosper in his hands. When he sees all that is accomplished by his anguish, he will be satisfied. And because of what he has experienced, my righteous servant will make it possible for many to be counted righteous, for he will bear all their sins. I will give him the honors of one who is mighty and great, because he exposed himself to death. He was counted among those who were sinners. He bore the sins of many and interceded for sinners.
Stuart Townend, so just mixed up singing the Word of God and the truth of God's word to one another and to him. So, well, last week I brought a message targeted directly to Alexis, and I didn't get finished with my message, but I am going to make this one for everybody today. So all of you need to be listening today. But last week we talked about how important it is for us to answer five questions, that our whole worldview is based on the answer to these five questions. And everybody has some kind of an answer. And according to the answer that you have, it will direct your value system, it'll direct the direction in your life, it will direct your sense of peace and confidence. It makes you who you are. And so we said last week that there are five questions, and I don't know, Brad, if you still have, yeah, there they are. How do I know what is true? So we said it's the question of authority. What is my authority? What do I go to answer the question, what is true? What is right? What is the truth? And I tell you, today, the vast number of people base their truth on something other than the Word of God. I mean, a lot of people base it on Facebook, or they base it on the internet, or they base it on CBS or NBC or ABC or CNN or something like that. And those are not true. They may hit some things that are accurate from time to time, but they are not the basis of truth. So how do I know what is true? And then second, where did I come from? Where did everything come from? What is the origin of life? And again, if you go to most colleges, even many high schools today, they will give you an answer that actually, in a sense, demeans the value of you. They will indicate that you are kind of some kind of cosmic accident, that you are here by chance, that you are here through an evolutionary process that leaves God totally out of the equation. And so that's an important question. How do I know what's true? Where did I come from? And then who am I? What is my identity as a person? Who really am I? And we talked about that a good bit last week. And then why am I here? What's my purpose in life? Do I have a reason for being here? We said last week that the number of suicides has just doubled almost over this past year in America, the most prosperous nation on the planet, the country that has the most opportunities, and yet more people and more young people are taking their own life than ever before in the history of our country. And it's because when they ask the question, why am I here? What's my purpose? They don't have an answer. Ernest Hemingway, American author who wrote a lot of wonderful stories, lived a dissolute life, a wasted life, and he ended up committing suicide. And he said that we are no more than a colony of ants on a burning log floating in the middle of a river. What a sad and pitiful and tragic way to think, that I am just part of a colony of ants on a burning log floating in the middle of a river. Well, he had no purpose in life. And of course, everybody's looking for a purpose. And they're trying to find a purpose in some way. And then, where am I going from here? What is my destiny? So, authority, origin, identity, purpose, and destiny. Those are the five things that determine our life view, our world view, how we make our decisions, how we look toward the future, how we evaluate what's going on around us, how we decide what is right and what is wrong, and what values I have in life. And I've been chatting with Mike over in Bulgaria this last week, and he listened to last Sunday's message, and he responded to it and said, "Wow, I love that sermon. I'm going to preach it over here in Bulgaria." And I said, "That's great." And then we got to talking about Bible characters that had to make decisions, hard decisions, and it was because they had the right answers to these questions that they were able to make right decisions. And the one that we talked about this week was Daniel. Daniel, when he was just a teenage boy, his country, he'd grown up basically in protecting, safe society. He had been, he was part of the nobility and had a good education and apparently godly parents. And what happened in 605 BC, Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, sent a host of troops into Israel, into Judea, and threatened to destroy the whole place, which he did do about 20 years later. But he took 70 of the prime youth, 70 young people that were the rising stars of their day. And some of our young people would have probably been in that group. You know, you would have been taken. And imagine being basically kidnapped, taken away, and carried off into a pagan land, and leaving behind everything you'd known, leaving your parents, leaving your teachers, leaving your rabbi, leaving everything that you'd known, and being transported 1,000 miles away into the most pagan land of that day, the land of Babylon. And we read about it in Daniel chapter 1. Let me just read some of this to you. Beginning in verse 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, which is Babylon, of course, to the house of his God, and he placed the vessels in the treasury of his God. So what Nebuchadnezzar ordered to be done was go into the temple and take out all the things that are dedicated to God, to Yahweh God, the Israel's God, and bring them over and put them into the pagan temple of our God, and we will dedicate them to a false god. And then the king commanded Ashpenaz, the chief eunuch, to bring some of the people of Israel, both of the royal family and of the nobility, youths without blemish, of good appearance, skillful in all wisdom, endowed with knowledge, understanding, learning, and competent to stand in the king's palace. He said, "I want you to bring back some of the young people from Judah. And I want you to find the cream of the crop. I want you to find the ones that are the best looking, the ones who are the smartest, the ones who could ace an ACT test. I want you to bring back the ones that are good communicators. You find the best they have, and you bring them over here. And then we will teach them the literature and the language of the Chaldeans." So here's the plan. We want to take the future leaders of the Jewish people and bring them over here, and we're going to train them to think like us. They've been thinking like Jews. They've been thinking like Yahweh worshipers. We're going to bring them over here, and we're going to put them in a 3-year program. We're going to send them to Babylonian College, and we're going to teach them the language and the literature and the value system and the worldview of the Babylonians. Now, I will tell you, when I read this, I just think about how many Christian young people who have grown up in good conservative churches and good conservative homes who go off to college, and by the time they come out of college, they have thrown away the value system and the worldview that they had when they went into college. And it amazes me, and I could get on a soapbox about this. I'm trying not to get on it too high, but it amazes me to see parents who spend $100,000 or more to put their kids into a pagan setting, to have their minds brainwashed and see their sons and daughters many times reject the faith that they were taught growing up. Now that's not, I mean, I don't know what the answer is. One is find a good Christian college that really, really holds the same values and the same worldview that you've trained your children in so that they can have that reinforced. While we were up in Branson, we went out to the College of the Ozarks, and it's a great Christian college. And in that college, they teach patriotic values, but also strong, heavy biblical values and a Christian worldview. And I thought, man, and also they have a commitment that no student will leave that college in debt. If they will either see to it that they have a job, some kind of work study while they're on campus, or some kind of grant or some kind of scholarship, and nobody graduates in debt. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? And they said, and by the way, there are other good Christian schools. So I know when I left home and went to college, I went to a Christian college, went to a Baptist college. But in that Baptist college, I was taught error. In my Bible classes, I was taught that the Bible was not fully inspired. I was taught that parts of the Bible may be inspiring, but they're not inspired. I was even taught that Jesus was probably an illegitimate child of some Roman soldier. I was taught that in a Bible class in a Baptist college. Now, thankfully, they've got rid of all those professors since then. Of course, they've all died since then, but they've got rid of those, and they've got some conservative teachers in those colleges now. So don't just look for a name, a Baptist college, or even a Christian college. Find out what they believe and what the teachers are like. Well, I'm going to get off my soapbox now for a minute. But this is what happened. This was the plan. And by the way, this has always been Satan's plan. Satan's plan has always been to isolate young people especially, but also adult people, to isolate them from an environment of truth and faith and put them in an environment where they can teach them the literature and the language of another way of thinking. And by the way, don't think it's not happening to you. Every time you turn on your television, there is a steady stream of error coming out of our television most of the time, almost every evening show that we watch, that is teaching us, training us in the language and the literature of an age that is opposed to the truth of God's word. And so this was the plan. And the king assigned them a daily portion of the food that the king ate and of the wine that he drank. And they were educated for 3 years. And then at the end of that time, they were to stand before the king. And among these were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah of the tribe of Judah. And I want you to notice, the very first thing that they did was change their names. They said, we know that the very names, Daniel, Azariah, Mishael, and Hananiah, they all are names that connect them to their God. Daniel means God is judge. And each of the names, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, all associated them with the God that they had grown up knowing and learning about. So the king said, we're going to change their identity. We're going to give them new names. So all the names, Belteshazzar, that was the name given to Daniel. By the way, all the way through the book of Daniel, he kept his name as Daniel. He said, I know you've given me another name, but I know who I am. I'm not a servant of Baal, which is what Belteshazzar means, servant of Baal. He said, I am Daniel. God is judge. And they called Hananiah Shadrach. They called Mishael Meshach, and they called Azariah Abednego. All three of those names connect them to pagan gods, pagan names. They said, we must first change their identity. We must determine who they are, and we must teach them that they are not who they thought they were. They are now who we say they are. So you see how this thing of identity figures into this. But Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine that he drank. Therefore he asked the chief of the eunuchs to allow him not to defile himself. And God gave Daniel favor and compassion in the sight of the chief of the eunuchs. And the chief of the eunuchs said to Daniel, I fear, my lord the king, who assigned your food and your drink. For why should he see that you were in worse condition than the youths who are your own age? So you would endanger my head with the king. And then Daniel said to the steward whom the chief of the eunuchs had assigned over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, test us for 10 days. Let us be given vegetables to eat and water to drink. And then let our appearance and the appearance of the youths who eat the king's food be observed by you. And then deal with us according to what you see. So he listened to them in this matter, and he tested them for 10 days. So for 10 days, they ate food that the Old Testament scriptures had approved. And what they had tried to do, they had tried to feed them foods that the Old Testament scriptures had said would defile them. And so at the end of the 10 days, it was seen that they were better in appearance and fatter in flesh than all the youths who ate the king's food. So the steward took away their food and the wine they were to drink, and he gave them vegetables. He gave them food that was approved by the word of God. As for these four youths, God gave them learning and skill in all literature and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. At the end of the time, that's the end of the 3 years, when the king had commanded that they all be brought in, the chief of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar, and the king spoke with them, and among all of them, none was found like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore, they stood before the king, and in every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters that were in his kingdom. And Daniel was there until the first year of King Cyrus. By the way, that spanned 70 years. Daniel was in the court, the king's court, for about 70 years. Let me just say a couple things about Daniel and about us. For one thing, it would have been easy for Daniel to do the wrong thing. He was away from his godly environment. He was away from his pastor, we might say. He was away from his parents. He was away from his community. And he was now immersed in a group of people who were doing wrong things. And it would have been so easy for Daniel to have just gone with the crowd. Today, so many Christian young people who go off to college, and so many Christian not so young people who are out in the workplace, they're surrounded by people who are foul-mouthed, dirty-minded, ungodly, reprobate, and it's just easy to just be pulled into that. If you've ever been out in a stream, out in a river, and you don't have to do anything to flow with the flow, do you? But if you want to make some progress going in this direction, it requires some effort, some determination. I got out in the Tennessee River one time, me and a friend of mine, and we were just gonna float down the river, which worked great. No effort at all, just floating down the river. And then we decided we want to go back. And it took us about 2.5 hours to make up what we had done in about 15 minutes. And we would row, row, row our boat, not so gently, up the stream. And every time our arms would get so tired and we'd stop to rest for just a few seconds, we just lose what we just gained. We finally were able to get over to the edge, out of the mainstream. And I've thought about that so many times. It's not just young people, is it? It's all of us. There's a current that's just moving along toward a waterfall of destruction. And it doesn't require anything, no effort at all, to just go with the flow. And it would have been so easy for Daniel and his friends to have done the wrong thing. And the other side of it is, it was costly for them to do the right thing. For them to take a stand and to say, I'm not going to defile myself. By the way, how did they know what would defile them? Because they had an authority, the Word of God. They had read in the law of God that certain foods were not to be eaten by those that were God's people. And they said, for us to eat what you're offering us to eat, even though it might be tasty, even though you might love it, even though it might not harm us in some ways, it would defile us, and we're not going to eat it. We're not going to drink it. And it was costly. They were criticized for it. In fact, the chief of the eunuch said, you know what? This could actually be a capital offense. It could cause me to lose my head if I let you make this decision. But they did make that decision. So they had an authority issue. They had an origin issue. They knew where they had come from. By the way, if you read the old Enuma Elish, it's called, it's the Babylonian creation myth. It's the most ridiculous thing in the world. It's about how this chaos monster called Tiamat was the chaos monster, and then Marduk, the hero, he kind of like a Captain America or somebody, he comes and with his sword he cuts Tiamat in half, and half of him he puts up in the sky and makes the sky, the other half he puts on the earth, and then they choose a lesser god, another one of their false gods, and they sacrifice him, and with his blood they sow it in drops, and out of those drops of blood humans come up, and that those humans come up to be slaves of the gods. Isn't that encouraging? Well, obviously Daniel was hearing all that. He was in the pagan college and they were teaching him all that stuff. But he said, no, I know where I came from. I know that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. It didn't have anything to do with Tiamat and Marduk and all this kind of stuff. God made the world, and he created man in his image, not to be a slave to serve the gods, but to be a representative, an image of God on this earth. He knew who he was, where he'd come from. He knew what his purpose was in life. And he knew what his destiny was. And the book of Daniel gives us more about the future resurrection of people than any other book in the Old Testament. So Daniel, because he was anchored in truth, because he knew he had the right authority, he had the right origin, he had the right sense of identity, he had the right purpose and the right destiny, he was able to say to the most powerful man on the planet, I will not defile myself. And he didn't say it in an arrogant or hateful way. In fact, he was very courteous. He said, I tell you what, give me an opportunity. Let me live according to the principles that God has laid down, and let these other men live according to your principles, and then give us a test at the end of 10 days. And at the end of those 10 days, everybody was amazed. They said, man, you guys, your eyes are brighter, your mind is sharper, you are healthier than these other people. And I'm just saying, God has a way for us to live. God has a truth for us to know. God has an origin for us to understand. God has a destiny for us to have confidence in. And then he has an identity for us as Christians. Here's who we are. We are sinners who have been bought with a price, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb of God. And we are now children of God. What great love, the Bible says, what great love God has bestowed upon us that we should be called children of God. That's who we are. That's who we are. We are God's children. So when we understand our authority, when God's word is truth to us, when we understand our origin, that God made us, we're his, when we understand our identity in Christ, and when we understand our purpose to glorify Him, when we understand our destiny to live with Him forever, we can have a worldview that gives us confidence and gives us safety. And I will say, it also gives us opposition. And we're going to find as you read through the book of Daniel, which I encourage greatly, when you read through the book of Daniel, you'll find two things. One, that believing the truth causes some people to hate you and even want to kill you. But also, believing the truth causes God to bless you. And there is no prophet in the Old Testament that received more insight and understanding about the coming course of history all the way up to the return of Jesus than Daniel. Daniel, because he loved God so much and trusted God and obeyed God, God entrusted him with insights that are absolutely amazing. So, my challenge to me and to you today, don't get sucked in to a pagan university. I'm not talking about college students only. I'm talking about all of us. There's a whole course, a whole system out there that wants to train your thinking and turn it away from the truth as it's revealed in God's Word. Don't let it happen. And the way you keep it from happening is by focusing on the truth and staying in the Word of God. I know you've heard this before, that when bank tellers are trained to spot counterfeit money, they don't ever show them any counterfeit money. They only show them genuine, real money. And they said, we want you to become so familiar with this. We want you to know the feel of it, the look of it. We want you to so understand what the real thing is that when some false thing comes by, you'll spot it just like that. You don't have to look at the false stuff. You just get to know the true, and you'll be able to spot the false. I've heard that. Hope it's true. Well, Al, do you know if that's true or not? Yeah. You know, well.
Sounds good,
doesn't it? Yeah, that's right. And I do know this, that if we are so saturated with the truth of God's Word, we don't have to go out and look for error. We'll spot it when we hear it. If we're so soaked in the Word of God, and we understand the truth as it is in Christ, that when we hear some error, we just recognize it, just like that. And if we hear it over the television, if we hear it over the internet, if we hear it from a classmate or from a fellow worker, we just spot it. Because we're focused on what's true. So our challenge is to fill our mind with God's truth to such a degree that we honor Him, that we face the opposition. And by the way, Daniel faced opposition. Hananiah, Azariah, Mishael, they faced opposition. They were thrown into a fiery furnace. Daniel was thrown into a lion's den when he was an old man. And yet, God was with them. That's another sermon. But God will be with you and God will be with me. If we're committed to truth, to hearing, reading, believing, living the truth, we'll face opposition. But in the end, we will be victorious. And those who follow the false system will perish. Father, I thank you that you know each one of us. You've called us by name. You know who we are. You've taught us your truth through your word. And I just pray that you'll help us to believe what you say. And I know that every day, in every way, we're bombarded by error. There's so much. Satan has an agenda that his first agenda is to get us to doubt and question your word. The very first statement he made to Adam and Eve was, "Has God said?" And I pray that you'll help us to answer that question to him. Yes, God has said, and we believe it, and we live by it. And I pray that you'll guard our hearts and our minds through the Savior that we trust, and that we will be able to walk in truth, not just to speak about it, but to walk in it, to live in it. And even if it's costly, help us to be willing to pay that cost in order to receive the reward that is surely awaiting those who love you and love your word. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing an invitation hymn this morning, one of our favorite songs. My wife and I, our favorite song is He Knows My Name. We're talking about knowing our identity. We get our identity from who God says we are. Not even who we say we are, but who God says we are. And I'm telling you, He knows your name, and He's called you by that name, and He wants you to live up to that name that He's given you. Child of God, Son of God, Daughter of God. And if you need to come this morning in some way to receive, to trust in Jesus, you come as we stand together and as we sing.